Mr. President.
Senator from Texas.
From El Paso to Brownsville, Texas, my state shares a 1,200-mile border with Mexico. If you were daring enough to attempt to walk that entire stretch, you'd trek through deserts, across mountains, through cities, and probably end up getting a little wet in the Rio Grande River. You would meet folks who are proud of the strong bonds our country has with our southern neighbor. Many, of course, have relatives in both countries. You'd talk to sheriffs, police officers, border patrol agents, all who care deeply about protecting our communities. And undoubtedly, you'd end up eating some good Tex-Mex along the way. In my time in the Senate, I've had the opportunity to meet countless Texans who live and work along the southern border, and I seek their advice and counsel on what Congress ought to do, what the federal government ought to do to protect them and their communities. What they tell me is that Texans and the nation rely on the billions of dollars of legitimate trade that comes across the ports of entry with Mexico. But with a growing volume of goods crossing our borders and the persistent staff shortages for the Customs and Border Protection, they want to make sure that there are no security gaps that can be exploited by criminals or slow down the legal movement of goods. That's a concern I share, and I continue to advocate for additional improvements in our ports of entry to protect this vital lifeline for our economy as well as our security. But just as these communities care deeply about the economic benefits of our shared border, they care deeply, of course, about their own safety and security. They believe that both can peacefully coexist, and so do I. During my visits, I've witnessed some of the horrific treatment that migrants receive at the hands of the criminals, including those that smuggle them. The truth is, these criminal organizations that move people and drugs and contraband across our border, they exploit our porous border and care nothing for human life. It's a commodity. It's the way they make money. They care nothing for the people they hurt. So they wring another dollar out of someone else's misery on a daily basis. And it's a high-volume business, too, and incredibly lucrative. I've seen the stash houses with windows lined with tinfoil inside a veritable cesspool that makes you want to gag or lose what you had for lunch. This is where the human smugglers cram large groups of illegal immigrants in unimaginable conditions while awaiting their transit to the interior of the United States. I've seen their logbooks where they record their corrupt transactions, correlating real-life human beings with their value in dollars and cents. I've talked to Border Patrol who have discovered tractor trailers full of people attempting to enter our country, some of whom never complete their journey because they die from exposure or are smothered to death in the crammed quarters. And in Brooks County, where the Foul Furious checkpoint of the Border Patrol is located about 50 miles north of the border, I've seen unmarked graves of the migrants who were trying to cross vast swaths of South Texas in the August heat in order to bypass the Border Patrol checkpoint, but then who were left to die by the smugglers. Their graves are marked only with identities like skull case or unknown female. Border security is not immoral, Mr. President, as Speaker Pelosi has shamefully claimed, but refusing to act in the face of evil is immoral. It's clear there's a crisis, as it is clear that it's our responsibility to restore safety and security and order. In my wildest dreams, I never would have imagined we would be debating if we should secure our borders, as we apparently are now. That's something we should all agree on. Instead, we should be focused on how to secure our borders and how to do it in a smart, responsible way. In my experience and learning from the experts, They tell me that's no one-size-fits-all solution. You can imagine in a 1,200-mile border with just Texas and Mexico, with the variety of topography and geography, that one-size-fits-all does not work. What works best in the Rio Grande Valley doesn't necessarily work in an urban environment like El Paso, with Juarez just right across the International Bridge. We need to customize solutions that meet the specific need rather than trying to dictate from here in Washington, thousands of miles away, a solution that solves nothing. We need to look at border security as a combination of three things. Physical infrastructure, yes, that includes barriers, walls, fences, vehicle barriers in appropriate locations, but it also includes technology, radar, ground sensors, drones, aerostats. This is a layered approach that provides flexibility for the experts on the ground to determine what is best for each sector, what is best for each part of our immense border, and implement the changes necessary to achieve desired results. As I said, in many areas, the landscape and location means that physical barriers may not be needed, may not be practical. In rural areas, technology, sensor technology or cameras may be sufficient, but we know we need additional boots on the ground too, because it's not enough to put a barrier in place or have a radar or a ground sensor in place if you don't have the Border Patrol to show up and detain people that they discover trying to make their way illegally into the United States or bringing drugs into the United States. So some combination of these three elements, I think, is always going to be needed, no matter where you're talking about. I'm proud of the work we've done here in the Senate, generally speaking, and I know that when we work together, we can do a lot of good. But logic and experience should tell us we shouldn't be the ones deciding how every inch of our southern border is secured. I don't claim to be an expert, although I have gone to school on the topic. Spent a lot of time talking to those people who are experts and learning from them. And I believe we need to let those experts drive the decision-making process on the right combination of resources needed to achieve operational control of the border. Unfortunately, our Democratic colleagues' refusal to invest in real border security has landed us in a partial government shutdown, resulting in 800,000 federal workers who on Friday won't get a paycheck. That's unnecessary. And they are, unfortunately, collateral damage to a political game which we should not be playing. I know many of these 800,000 federal workers are already anxious about how they will make a car payment, or how they'll pay their mortgage, or their rent, or how they'll put food on the table. That's completely unnecessary, this shutdown. I'm afraid this debate on border security, of course, is not really a debate about border security at all. It's a way for congressional Democrats to take a stand against a president they oppose, while putting border communities at risk and sending the men and women who protect them to work without pay. This battle's gone on too long, and I can only hope that Speaker Pelosi and Minority Leader Schumer show some leadership rather than continue to take the low road. This shouldn't be about winning a partisan fight. It should be about protecting our citizens and stemming the tide of illegal immigration, drugs, and contraband entering our country. If there was ever a time, now is a time for common sense to prevail and end this senseless shutdown. Mr. President, on another matter, I want to share a few words about an American hero I had the pleasure to get to know, Mr. Richard Arvin Overton. Richard's story began more than a century ago on May the 11th, 1906 in Bastrop County, Texas. Throughout his young life, Richard held a variety of jobs, landscaping, picking cotton, working at a furniture store, and building homes. In 1940, Richard enlisted in the United States Army, and he began his military service at Fort Sam Houston in San Antonio. Serving with the 1887th Engineer Aviation Battalion, an all-black unit, One of its first stops was Pearl Harbor, the day after what we now know as the Westlock disaster. In an interview in 2016, Richard recalled that day, seeing the water turn red from the blood of his brothers, saying, "I didn't look the same, but I got out all right." This is only the first stop in Richard's tour, which later led him into the Pacific Theater. His service included stops in Guam, Palau, and Iwo Jima, where he witnessed firsthand some of the darkest days in our country's modern history. When the war ended, Richard returned to Texas and built a home on Hamilton Avenue. He originally re-entered the furniture business and then began working for the State Treasury Department. At the spry age of 85, Richard Overton decided to retire. In 2013, the 107-year-old Richard Overton made his first trip to Washington, D.C. with an honor flight. He was able to witness the memorial built to honor his service and his comrades who died in battle, a sight that brought him to tears. While his military service alone deserves our praise, that's not the only thing that brought Richard national attention. His comments about the keys to his longevity and his long life, in particular his daily routine, made Richard an internet sensation. His penchant for enjoying coffee with whiskey and 12 cigars a day won hearts and caused all of us to question the secret to his long life. Richard also enjoyed a bowl of ice cream every night, always butter pecan. He called this the Overton diet and welcomed anyone interested to give it a shot. Richard used his newfound fame to continue life as he always had, but with more fans eager to stop by and say hello while he was sitting on the front porch. He continued to live in the same house he built after the war, although the street name has now been changed to carry his name, Richard Overton Avenue. I first met Richard in 2013, and I remember the day my wife and I, Sandy, met him at his home in Austin. And I was taken aback to learn he had just gotten through mowing his lawn that morning, 107 years old and still mowing his lawn. Sadly, on December the 27th, 2018, the story of this American hero came to an end. At the ripe old age of 112 years, Richard passed away, leaving a host of cousins and extended family members. Yesterday, I introduced a resolution with my colleague, Senator Cruz, to honor this great man and his military service and his enduring legacy. Our country's lost a true patriot, our state has lost a legend, and our community has lost a dear friend. Mr. President, I yield the floor.